All right. So in the last class, we were looking at the ID versus VGS and VDS characteristics of a NMOS transistor. And what we found was that it can be sort of approximately given by an equation like this. This is for the condition where VDS is less than VGS minus VT, and similarly when VDS is greater than or equal to VGS minus VT, it becomes something that's just related to VGS minus VT the whole square. Okay. So in the second case, it no longer depends on VDS. The other thing that can be noticed is it depends on VGS minus VT the whole square. So in other words, it depends on the square of the gate overdrive. That VGS minus VT is called the gate overdrive. Okay. Now these are a very simplistic model of how the transistor works. Real transistors work approximately like this, but the actual current that you will see through it will differ quite a lot. Okay. Now one of the parameters, one of the factors that causes a difference is the fact that while deriving this equation, we assumed that the electron under the influence of the drain to source electric field are essentially going to flow with a velocity which is proportional to the electric field. Okay, so that's where that term mu n comes in. Mu n is the mobility. Mu n into electric field, that is dv by dx, is the velocity of the electron. Okay, and at the end of the last class, we saw that if we just do the calculation, for a 180 nanometer process, approximately what we can get is delta V by L. In other words, this is just VDS divided by L. This comes out to be approximately 2×10⁵ meters per second. Right? Now the first thing that you can see over there is this is greater than 10⁵ meters per second. Okay? Not by much, but still it is greater than 10⁵ meters per second. What that means is 10⁵ meters per second is approximately the maximum physical velocity that electrons are able to reach within the silicon medium. Okay. This is due to the physical nature of the medium itself. They are not able to accelerate beyond that, which means that the current that I expected, right, which is given by this term out here, the mu n c of W by L into VGS minus V to the whole square by 2, it's unlikely that I'll be able to reach that much value of current, because at some point I have reached the saturation of the current even before the channel pinched off, because the velocity that is required for the electrons became too high. Okay. Now, the way that that is modeled is by bringing in another factor, another term, which we call VDSAT, the voltage for velocity saturation. So velocity saturation is the term that is used to refer to this phenomenon that just happened, right? What is the main root cause over here? Essentially what has happened is that the electric field has become so high that the electrons are not able to get to the velocity which will be given by the term mu n into E. Okay? One way of modeling it is to say that the mu n itself changes, the mobility changes, right? But instead of that, instead of modeling a change in the mobility, what we do instead is to say that we can just treat it as an overall saturation of the velocity itself. Okay? Now, under these conditions, what we say is the ID is given by the expression mu n C of W by L VD sat into VGS minus VT minus VD sat by 2. Okay? Where did this expression come from? Again, I am not deriving it. This is an approximation. This is just a very first order rough approximation of what the true parameter is. But it's good enough for our working. Okay? Now, if you take all these three equations, right, 1, 2 and 3, what we can do is combine them together and write it as so we bring in one new term, V min. Okay? Write out the expression mu m c of W by L into V min times VGS minus VT minus V min by 2, where V min is the minimum among the three terms VGS minus VT, VDS, and VD sat. Okay? This is just an approximation of the current equation that is used in order to make it easy to do hand calculation. Right? A real electronic simulator would not work with this equation, it would work with a much more accurate version of what we have over here. Right? So if this is the case, let's sort of try to get an intuitive understanding of what this is saying. Right? What are the three different regions that you can have? One is, among these three terms, VGS minus VT is the minimum. Okay? Of course, all of this is under the condition that VGS is greater than VT and the channel has been formed. Right? If the channel is not formed at all, what we have is VGS minus VT is less than 0, there is no channel. Effectively, for all practical purposes, we say that there is no current. Okay? In practice, as we see, there is a very small current, but it's orders of magnitude less than the current that we are that you would get from this equation. So we treat it as an off condition for the present. Okay? Now, first possibility. The minimum value is VGS minus VT. Okay? That corresponds to, or actually, sorry, let me change that. I'll consider first the minimum being VDS. Okay? So in other words, VGS minus VT has been applied. Okay? A channel has been formed. And a very small value of VDS, smaller than VGS minus VT, has been applied to the drain to source terminal. What does the current equation become? It just goes back to the old this expression out here, right? If you look at this, what is happening is, as VDS increases, the current increases, but the rate at which it is increasing keeps on decreasing because there is one minus VDS square by 2 term over there, which is sort of bringing down the parabola. Okay? This is what we call the linear region of operation. right? The second possibility is VGS minus VT is the minimum among the three terms, right? Among these three terms over here, VGS minus VT is the minimum. What does that imply? Current equals mu n C of W by L, VGS minus VT whole square by 2. And this we call the saturation region, because the current has saturated, the channel has pinched off, there is no further increase in the current. Okay? What does this intuitively mean? VGS minus VT is greater than 0, so a channel has been formed. But VGS minus VT is still quite small. Okay? Which means any VGS that you apply has essentially caused the channel to pinch up very quickly. Right? And as a result, even though the current increased up to a point, it has now saturated and has become a constant. The third possibility is that VD sat is the minimum among the three terms. In this case, the current will be given by mu m C of W by L VD sat into VGS minus VT minus VD sat by 2. And this we call velocity saturation. Okay? Now look at this equation carefully. First thing we can notice is the current under velocity saturation is proportional to VGS minus VT. It is linearly related to VGS minus VT. So if VGS is larger, the current is going to be larger. Okay? But it is not VGS minus VT the whole square, unlike saturation. So in velocity saturation, the current is only going up linearly with VGS. Okay? The second thing you can notice over here is, it is independent of VDS. So it is truly a saturation condition. It is just like the normal saturation, in that the current does not any further increase with VDS. But on the other hand, it is determined by some other term, VD sat, which is once again a process related parameter. Okay? In terms of the ID versus VDS characteristics that we saw earlier, what we saw was the current sort of increases and then stabilizes. And this is a quadratic expression. Right? Proportional to VGS minus VT the whole square. This is under regular saturation. What happens under velocity saturation? You see something similar. Because after all, the initial part will remain the same. Right? So the red curves, in other words over here, are showing you what happens when velocity saturation kicks in. Right? One is, for a given value of VGS minus VT, the maximum current that you get is lower than under the regular saturation condition. The second is, for a given delta in the VGS, given change in VGS, in the original saturation, long channel transistor, the current would go up as VGS minus VT the whole square. Over here it only goes up as VGS minus VT. Okay? So those two things are effectively what happens is the maximum current that is coming out of the transistor has decreased. Okay? Now, as we will see later, one of the main things that you would like to do is for this transistor to act as a current source, so that it can deliver enough current for the charging and discharging of transistors further down the line. Okay? So if the maximum current that it can give has been reduced, that's not really a good thing. It means that your entire circuit is going to behave in some sense slower. Okay? Now we'll get to that in more detail later when we talk about propagation delay. But for the time being, the takeaway from this is, under velocity saturation, for a given value of VGS, the current that you get is less, which is not good. Okay? Alright, so that's as far as velocity saturation is concerned, and the important thing is this particular equation. Right? Please keep this in mind, memorize this, it is one of the few equations that you are actually required to sort of memorize in this course. Right? The main reason for that is because this is the simplest equation which can be used in order to determine for a given transistor very quickly to a first order, decide whether it is in saturation, velocity saturation, or in the linear region. Why is that important? Because from that you can get an estimate of how much is the current that is going to flow through that transistor. And therefore, what is the kind of behavior, the voltage transfer characteristics of whatever gates that you are trying to build, how does that look? You can form estimates of that by using this equation. So even though this equation is not accurate, right, this is a very, very rough approximation, it is a very useful approximation for the kind of calculations that we need to do. Okay? Alright, so that is as far as the velocity saturation is concerned. Now what we are going to do is look at a couple of other non-idealities that occur in the construction of transistors or in the operation of transistors. Okay? One of them is a phenomenon called channel length modulation. Right? What happens over here is, we have this depletion region that have formed around both the N plus region, right? And after the depletion, this region immediately under the gate oxide has been inverted to form the channel. Okay? Now, as VDS increases or VD increases, effectively what will happen to this depletion region? What do you expect will happen to that depletion region when that reverse bias over there increases? The width should increase, right? So it increases. Effectively what that does is it also has an impact on the channel itself. Okay? Once again, this is purely an intuitive understanding, right? The actual details of how it works can be worked out through the physics of the system. But intuitively what is happening is, you can think of this change in the depletion width over here as affecting the channel length. Right? This is the channel length. The separation between the drain and the source. Okay? Effectively what this is doing is decreasing the channel length. Right? By increasing the depletion width, the effective channel that is available has slightly decreased. So what happens when the channel length decreases? What will happen to the current? It should increase. Right? Why is that? Because we have W by L. So if L decreases, the current should increase. Okay? Okay? Now, this is once again a minor effect. Okay, because the amount of change in the channel length that we are talking about is relatively quite small over here. Okay. As a result, one of the things that we can do is 1 over L minus delta L, right? Approximately treated as L plus delta L, or right, approximately. So the idea is that the plus, the decrease in the channel length in the denominator, something proportional to that is what you are going to get in the numerator. Right? And what we say is that the amount of decrease can be taken as proportional to the delta V that is applied over there, that is the VDS. The voltage that is applied over there, which in turn is causing the channel to shrink slightly. As a first order approximation, we can take the change in the current to be proportional to that increase. Okay? And the way that it is modeled is that we say that the ID is equal to the ID naught, that is the ideal equation, multiplied by 1 plus lambda times VDS, where lambda is a proportionality factor. Okay? Keep in mind, this lambda has nothing to do with the lambda that we spoke about when we were talking about layout rules. Remember when I talked about scalable CMOS, I talked about one 2 lambda factor. That has nothing whatsoever to do with this lambda. That lambda factor has dimensions of length. Right? This has dimensions of 1 over voltage. It's just a coincidence that both are using the same term, but they have no connection at all other than that. Okay? So the important point, what happens as a result of this 1 plus lambda VDS? This effect 1 plus lambda VDS is present whether or not you are saturated. Okay, so even after the saturation, the channel has pinched off, what we are saying is the channel length can still be modulated by this VDS parameter. Okay? And the result of that is an increase in the overall current, which means that the current which normally would have looked like this is now instead going to look like this. Okay? This lambda is a small parameter, so the overall slope that we are talking about over here is quite small, but it is not completely negligible. Okay? Now, where this becomes a real issue is much more in analog circuits than in digital circuits. In analog circuits, you are concerned with getting the output impedance of the MOS transistor to be as high as possible. Right? But when VDS and ID are related to each other, it means that ID is no longer independent of VDS. Effectively, it's as though there is some kind of a resistance which is the parameter matching the two together. Okay? The higher the value of this slope, the lower that resistance, which is bad news for an analog designer. For digital circuits, for the most part, you don't care too much about it. Right? This just has some effect. But in a digital circuit, mostly we are operating either at 0 volt or at VDD, the supply. Okay? And all that we care about is how quickly can we switch between one to the other. So the details of how long it takes and of, you know, how much is that impedance provided by this lambda parameter is not a big issue as far as digital circuits are concerned. Okay? Alright. The next non-ideality of these transistors that we are going to consider is something called the body bias effect. Now, all our initial derivations, or we didn't do the derivations in detail, but all the derivations of the equations that we go through for this, are under the assumption, two assumptions. The bulk terminal is grounded, source terminal is also grounded. Okay? The second assumption is not always required. Okay? It is entirely possible for me to have a circuit where the source terminal is not going to be at ground potential. Okay? The bulk is a different matter. I can somehow ensure that it's at ground potential. There may be reasons why I don't want to do that, but for the time being we can assume that bulk is at ground. Okay? Now, what happens with this scenario? Right? Under this condition, let's say that the bulk is at ground and the source terminal is at some potential higher than ground, some positive potential. Okay? This reverse biases the source to bulk junction. Okay? The amount of that reverse bias is given by the voltage between source to bulk, VSD. Right? That reverse bias is actually going to make it harder to invert the channel. Okay? The detailed derivation, once again I am skipping over here. Essentially what happens as a result of that reverse bias is that it can be modeled as a change in the threshold voltage. The voltage that is required to invert and form the channel. Right? Until the channel forms, there can be no conduction of current. What happens over here is, as a result of this reverse bias, it becomes harder to invert the channel and therefore for current to flow. So this is modeled as follows. The threshold voltage is modeled as some nominal threshold voltage plus a constant of proportionality gamma times square root of VSD plus one parameter phi s minus square root of phi s. Okay? Now this term phi s is dependent on the work function of gate and substrate. The gate terminal, that is the polysilicon or metal or whatever you are using as the gate terminal, and the substrate. Okay? In other words, as far as we are concerned, it is some constant that we need to know. Gamma is also a proportionality factor, it's a process parameter. The important point over here is, as a result of this change, right, if there is some value of VSD which is not equal to 0, the threshold voltage is higher than it would normally be. Okay? What happened to the threshold voltage is higher. For a given value of VGS, what will happen to the current? It decreases. Right? Because VGS minus VT. If VT has increased, the VGS minus VT has decreased. Therefore, for a given VGS, the amount of current that you can get will reduce. Okay? Now, this can be good news under certain conditions. Right? Like I told you, when VGS is 0, when it's less than VT, the entire circuit is supposed to be in a reverse bias, or is supposed to be in the cutoff condition. Right? No current flowing through the system at all. Okay? But in practice, there will be some leakage current, which are non-trivial, right? Which cannot be completely ignored. Okay? If I am able to increase the threshold voltage, it turns out that those leakage currents also decrease. Okay? So there might be conditions under which I actually want to increase the reverse bias over here and therefore increase the threshold voltage. Right? But in general, it's a bad thing. I don't want it to happen because it causes a reduction in my current. Okay? These two parameters, gamma as well as phi s, are dependent on the process. One of the things that you can find out about gamma if you actually look at the equation that you use for it is, gamma is proportional to the T of the thickness, oxide thickness. Okay, actually proportional to square root of T of, but okay. The point is, if T of increases, gamma increases and vice versa. Okay? So what does that tell you about this effect? What this is called the body bias effect. What do you expect will happen to this effect as we go to smaller and smaller geometry? When I'm going from 180 nanometers down to 90 nanometers or 65 or 40 and so on, what happens to the T of also reduces. Okay? Along with reducing the length and width of the transistor, one of the parameters that is also changed is to reduce the oxide thickness. Okay? Now that's not absolutely necessary, but it is the way that processes scale. Okay? So while processes scale, the T of also reduces. When T of reduces, what will happen to gamma? It reduces, which means that this effect is less prominent in newer technologies than it was in older technologies. Okay? But it's still not completely negligible, it cannot be ignored. It's very much a factor that needs to be considered, but the effect is reduced. Okay? Alright, so what are the things that we have seen so far? We have looked at the basic transistor equation. We also brought in the non-idealities, one of them being velocity saturation. Right? Then comes the channel length modulation and the body bias effect. Velocity saturation in particular is usually referred to as the short channel effect. Okay? Many of these are related to short channel effects on transistors. Velocity saturation is one of the most prominent short channel effects. Okay. Apart from this, there are a few more non-idealities or problems that you need to consider as far as transistors are concerned. One of them is the so-called sub-threshold conduction. Now, over here, I'm just going to draw the symbol of a transistor. This is typically the symbol used for an NMOS transistor, right? The bulk terminal is ignored because we assume that the bulk for NMOS is always connected to ground. Okay? If it is not connected to ground, then you need to explicitly show the bulk terminal and show how it is supposed to be connected. But otherwise, it is usually ignored. Okay. If VGS is less than VT, what we expect is that ID is equal to 0. Okay? Abruptly. It just drops abruptly to 0 and stays at 0. Right? Now, according to the equations that we wrote down also, this is what will happen. Right? Because if you go back to this equation here, and put in VGS is equal to VT, okay, what happens? Current becomes 0 because VGS minus VT is equal to 0 is going to be the minimum among these three terms. You plug in that value over there, you are going to get 0. Okay, so ID becomes 0, ID exactly 0 according to this equation. But like I already said, this equation is not exact. What happens in practice is that as you go below VT, that is VGS goes below VT, the current starts decreasing. It starts decreasing very rapidly, right? In fact, exponentially, but it does not drop instantly to zero. Okay? What that means is that if I was to take the same ID versus VGS, okay, ID versus VGS on a linear scale looks like this. What will it look like on a linear scale? VGS has to be greater than VT before IDS even starts to flow. Right? After that, what is the peak current for a given value of VGS? VGS minus VT whole square or VGS minus VT something proportional to that if velocity saturation is coming in. I'm going to ignore velocity saturation and say that this is proportional to VGS minus VT the whole square. Okay? If it was velocity saturated, then the current would be slightly less. It would go something like this. Okay? The point is, below VGS, according to this diagram, the current is abruptly zero. In practice, if you were to plot this on a log scale instead of on a linear scale, right, what will happen is there is some value of VT. On a log scale, the quadratic looks something like this. Right, because x square is less than e power x, so it essentially ends up looking like a dipping function, doesn't matter. The point is there will be some current that flows even when VGS is equal to VT. And as VGS goes below VT, this starts dropping. Okay? Remember, by the way, that because this is a log scale, there is no zero on the y-axis, right? It will be some 10 power minus 6 amperes, 10 power minus 7, 10 power minus 8, 10 power minus 9, 10, 11, 12, so on. Okay? So this might be approximately, let's say, 10 power minus 8 or, you know, around 10 nano amperes or so. After some time, it will reach 1 nanoamp, 100 picoamp, 10 picoamp, and so on. Okay, keeps on going down. Right? There is an exponential reduction in current. Which is good news, right? Because an exponential is one of the fastest growing functions, or if we are in this case, since we are trying to look at the decreasing side, so also the fastest reducing function, one of the fastest reducing functions. Okay, so for every fixed delta Vgs, there is a factor of something decrease in the current. Okay, in fact, the term that is usually used in order to represent this is, we take the slope of this, right? We call that parameter S. Okay? And, well, instead of writing it in terms of amperes per volt, okay? We think of it in terms of how many millivolts or how many volts of change is required in order to get a factor of 10 change in the current. Okay? And that factor S is then expressed in millivolts per decade. Okay? So what does a decade mean? It means a factor of 10 change in whichever axis you are talking about. In this case, the y-axis, I want the y-axis to change by a factor of 10. That is one decade change. So going from 10 nanoamperes to 1 nanoamperes is one decade. 1 nanoamps to 100 picoamps is one decade. Okay? How many millivolts of VGS change is required for one decade change in current? Okay? And this parameter is a very crucial parameter as far as we are concerned. Ideally, what do you want it to be? Ideally, what do you want S to be? How many millivolts change do you want for a one decade change in current? Ideally, zero. Okay? So, in ideal situation, S should be zero, as small as possible. Because even a very small change in the VGS, I want the current to drop very sharply. Okay? In practice, S turns out to be between 60 to 90 millivolts per decade. Again, depending on the process, plus some other parameters that have an influence on the subthreshold conduction. Okay? Now, what is the impact of subthreshold current? The main problem as far as subthreshold current is concerned is, it is a current that is flowing when you are under the impression that the transistor is off. Okay? So normally the transistor is supposed to be off, no current flowing through it, but this equation tells you that there is still a finite amount of current flowing. Okay? That essentially means that it is leaking. It is a current which is undesirable, it should not have been there. Okay? So this, all of this, the subthreshold current is typically considered a leakage and an undesirable phenomenon. Okay? There are of course some circuits that try to take advantage of this, which go into the subthreshold region and try to operate over there, because the currents that are involved are very tiny compared to the currents in the on region. Therefore, if you are able to somehow operate in the subthreshold region, perhaps there are some benefits to be incurred. Right? But in general, this is undesirable and it forms a leakage. Okay? Which means that this question, this S value, the subthreshold slope, 60 to 90 millivolts per decade, you would like to make it as close to 60. 60 is sort of a physical barrier, right? I mean, going below that may be difficult. Right? That depends on the physics of the system itself. But if there are some ways by which you can reduce this slope as much as possible, that's also a desirable condition to have. Okay? Now, apart from all of these, there are a couple of other non-idealities that I am just going to sort of mention by name and move on. I am not even going to go into the details of them. One of them is so called brain induced barrier lowering. As you can sort of infer from the name, what it's saying is the barrier to flow of current, right, is being reduced slightly by the drain voltage. So the fact that there is a drain voltage is in turn having an effect on what gate voltage is required in order to invert the channel. Okay, this is not exactly the same as channel length modulation. Channel length modulation is after channel has formed, what happens when there are further increases in the drain voltage. What this is saying is, even before the channel forms, the fact that there is a drain voltage can cause a difference in the amount of voltage which is required for the channel to form. Okay? Barrier lowering. What does that mean? The barrier is lowered, the threshold voltage comes down as a result of the drain voltage increase. Okay, so if you were to plot VT as a function of VDS, you would find that there is a reduction. Okay, another phenomenon that we have is something called gate induced drain leakage. Okay, once again, what this is saying is, you have a transistor, some voltage applied to the gate. What happens when you apply a voltage to the gate? To the current that is flowing over here. Okay? Ideally, no current is supposed to be flowing because the gate voltage is still less than VT. But in practice, some amount of current does start to flow. Okay? So VG can change the amount of drain to source leakage current. Okay. Once again, I am not going into the details of this. These are just terms that I am introducing so that you are familiar with them. We are not looking into them in much detail at this point, although they do have strong effects on digital circuits. Right? Especially anything that involves leakage is a big deal for digital circuits, because unlike analog circuits, digital circuits are usually in the mode of being off, right? There is no current flowing through them. Current flows through a digital circuit only when switching is occurring. That is when you are doing some computation, when you are moving from one mode to another. In the normal state of affairs, there should be no current flowing through the digital circuit. Anything which flows through under those static conditions is called leakage current. Now, given the number of transistors that is there on a typical modern system on chip, right, several hundred million, possibly up to a billion or so, even a small amount, nanoamps of current of leakage, can translate into amperes of current at the system level. Okay? So you cannot have this kind of leakage even at the nanoamp scale. So any form of leakage that happens in the system needs to be reduced, especially for digital systems. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. In the next class, we'll look at the capacitances that are involved in the behavior or the functioning of a regular MOS transistor.